We present TinyAD, automatic differentiation and geometry processing made simple. I am Patrick Schmidt, and this is joint work with Janis, David Bommes, Marcel Campen, and Leif Kobbelt. TinyAD is a small C++ library for automatic differentiation, targeted specifically at geometry processing. It computes first and second order derivatives, in particular of sparse problems on meshes, by differentiating small subproblems. TinyAD only depends on the eigenmatrix library and is compatible with many different mesh libraries. Our goal is making nonlinear optimization in a geometry processing context more accessible. With this simple tool, we're able to significantly speed up research workflows. We can write both problem formulations and optimization algorithms in very few lines of code, directly in the C++ environment, while always having easy access to derivatives, most importantly to sparse Hessian matrices, which can otherwise be extremely tedious to obtain. We're able to very quickly experiment with different objective functions without having to worry about the details of differentiation. There are many different problems in geometry processing that involve some form of nonlinear optimization, where we define an objective function that we want to minimize with respect to a vector of continuous variables. For example, in parametrization, the variables are vertex positions in the plane, and the objective function could measure texture distortion, or measure distortion between different surfaces, or measure element quality for quad remeshing. In mesh deformation, vertex positions are optimized in 3D, either for animation or for surface registration, or for developable surface approximation, and much more. Variables could also correspond to tangent vectors on a surface, which are then used for remeshing or for fabrication. So there are a lot of examples that involve problems of this general format. One way of solving them is via Newton-style algorithms, where we start with an initial point x and then iteratively update it such that the objective decreases. In each iteration, we usually need the derivatives of the objective function at the current point. For a scalar function of n variables, these are the gradient of f, an n-dimensional vector of partial derivatives, and usually also the Hessian matrix that contains second-order derivatives. Often this matrix is sparse, and its sparsity pattern is related to the underlying mesh connectivity. We can then use these derivatives to compute an update direction and perform a line search to decide how far to move into that direction. There are many different variants of such algorithms, but they all require finding and implementing these derivatives, which can be quite a big roadblock in practice. We could analytically derive their expressions on paper and then manually implement them in code, but this is very work-intensive. It's hard to track down errors, and most importantly, if we want to try a new objective function, we'd have to do all the work again. Another approach is to use computer algebra systems like Maple, Mathematica, or SymPy. These automate the main differentiation workload and can even generate derivative code for us, but this is still a two-step process where we need to switch between different software ecosystems, and this is challenging to fully automate. Also, these tools sometimes produce excessively large expressions that are slow to generate and slow to compile. Automatic differentiation, on the other hand, means that we can implement our objective function directly in the target language and its derivatives are computed for us. There are many software packages for this, but it's not easy to find the right one for a specific task. Often, only a subset of language features is supported. We have to consider runtime performance. Not all libraries offer second-order derivatives, which we often need in our context. Direct support for mesh-based sparsity patterns is a rare feature, and a big deal-breaker are often control flow restrictions. For example, loops or branching in the differentiated code might just not be possible or are at least more complicated to realize. And finally, we have to consider how difficult it is to integrate an autodiff library into our project. Here we are focusing on a C++ environment. We believe that geometry processing research could really benefit from an easily accessible tool that is tailored specifically to our use case, in particular to computing sparse Hessian matrices of mesh-based problems. So we looked at different approaches to automatic differentiation, and our key insight is that actually the simplest and most straightforward approach is the one that works best in our case. I will now briefly show you our perspective on these different approaches. I will then introduce our library TinyAD for small and dense problems, followed by our interface for large and sparse problems. And finally, I will show you how we are now able to produce very compact implementations of many nonlinear algorithms. Given an implementation of our objective function, we can consider its computation graph, where each node is a scalar value that exists at a certain time during program execution. There are n inputs corresponding to our variable vector x and one output f of x. The value of each intermediate node is computed from its predecessors via some operation. Now automatic differentiation techniques attach additional information to these nodes and then perform one or more passes through this graph to compute both f of x and its derivatives. We categorize different approaches along three criteria. First, the mode of differentiation, forward or backward. Second, the time of differentiation, before compilation, at compile time or at runtime. And third, whether or not this computation graph even needs to be represented explicitly. In forward mode, each node carries not only its scalar value, but also its derivatives with respect to all input variables. That is, a full gradient vector and Hessian matrix are attached to each scalar. An operation has access to the derivatives of its arguments and produces the derivatives of its result. So only a single forward pass is necessary, just as in the original program execution. And we can then read the final derivatives from the output node. In contrast, backward mode first computes only the value of each node and then attaches a single scalar to it, the derivative of the output value f of x with respect to that node. And these are computed in a backward pass via the chain rule. So for this, we first need to construct this graph in a forward pass and then traverse it backwards until we're able to read off the gradient of f at the input nodes. Second-order derivatives will require additional passes. Now, asymptotically, backward mode is more efficient, since it avoids storing a full gradient and Hessian at each node. However, in practice, other aspects can easily outweigh this theoretic complexity, especially if we're only interested in small problem sizes. We did an experiment with a simple expression, here the Euclidean vector norm, where we computed its gradient and Hessian for increasing sizes. We compared a forward mode implementation to an established backward mode implementation and find that there is quite a large range of problem sizes for which forward mode can indeed be a lot faster. And if we're able to split large problems into small subproblems, we can benefit from this a lot. For example, for small 6x6 Hessian matrices, forward mode was 70 times faster than backward mode in this experiment. One way of implementing either forward or backward mode could be via source code transformation. So before compilation, a software would parse our source code, symbolically compute derivatives, and then generate derivative code. This has the biggest potential for code optimization, but it's also the least flexible and the most difficult to integrate into a programming workflow. Compile-time differentiation can be achieved, for example, via operator overloading in C++, in a way such that all derivative expressions are fully known to the compiler and are available for compiler optimization. At least in forward mode, this is very simple to realize. And lastly, only assembling derivative expressions at runtime is the most flexible option, but also rules out many performance optimizations. In backward mode, we always have to explicitly represent the computation graph somehow because we will traverse it more than once. This could be in form of an abstract syntax tree, of expression templates, or by tracking operations on a tape at runtime. If we in addition want to allow dynamic branching and loops in our code, the structure of this graph itself changes at runtime, which causes a lot of extra challenges. In forward mode, however, we don't necessarily have to construct this graph at all and can just follow the original control flow of our function once. So we chose the combination of forward mode and compile time differentiation. It's simple to implement, automatically benefits from compiler optimization, and adds no restrictions on branching and loops, because we don't explicitly construct a computation graph. Its only disadvantage is the asymptotic runtime complexity, but as we saw, this is not really an issue if we only differentiate small subproblems. Later we will compare against a few other packages, for example Acorns, which offers source code transformation in either forward or backward mode, but as such has limited support for branching and loops. ADOL-C is an established package for backward mode differentiation at runtime that requires us to record our objective function on a tape before it can be differentiated. And most similar to our approach is an autodiff implementation that is part of the Mitsuba renderer. It follows the same basic approach, but does not specifically address sparse problems on meshes. Let's look at TinyAD for small and dense problems first. All we have to do for compile-time differentiation in forward mode is to provide a scalar data type that carries derivatives, and then overload operations with differentiation rules. We implemented this in the type TinyADDouble. It receives the dimensionality of our problem as a template argument, and its constructor takes a value and the index of that variable. Here we construct a second variable and can then perform any computations using the set of available operations. We can always query the derivatives of any TinyAD double, and these derivatives are stored as eigen matrices. Since we can work with TinyAD doubles just like with regular doubles, we can also use them inside of eigenvectors and matrices. So for this, let's first create a type def for our scalar type, and then initialize a vector of three variables that are now indexed for us automatically. This already gives us access to differentiating all kinds of matrix and vector operations that are provided by eigen. For example, products, determinants, normalization, inversion, and so on. All of these are simply differentiated on a per scalar level. We can of course still define any kinds of constant values using regular doubles, and then freely mix these into our computations. Here, for example, we compute the angle between two 3D vectors and differentiate only with respect to one of them. From a user perspective, the big advantage is that all of this works natively in C++ without any external tools or custom compile steps. We just need to include a single header file. At runtime, this code will be very fast because all computations can be inlined by the compiler, so both the matrix expressions by eigen and the derivative code by TinyAD are visible to the compiler at once and can be optimized together. The fact that the size of gradients and Hessians is known at compile time also helps with optimization. And these aspects play a much bigger role than theoretical runtime complexity, at least up to a certain problem size. Luckily, larger problems can often be split into small subproblems, and we build a simple interface that helps us with that. Often our objective is a sum over a set of elements, for example associated with the triangles of our mesh, and each element only depends on a small number of variables. This means that we can efficiently differentiate these small fixed-size problems separately and only then assemble the global derivatives. Our interface lets us express these local global relationships very compactly and takes care of all the index mapping. For this, we use the notions of variable handles, these could be the vertices of our mesh, and element handles, these could be the triangles. But both of these choices are flexible. We could choose a completely different set of variables and any other kind of local stencils as elements. For now, let's assume that we want to map a triangle mesh to the plane. We start by constructing a TinyAD scalar function and pass a list of variable handles. Here we use vertex handles from the open mesh library, but we could use primitives from any other mesh library as long as they can be converted into indices. Or if we were working with libigl, then our variable handles would just be a set of row indices into a vertex matrix. We then declare that each vertex is associated with two scalar variables, here the UV coordinates in the plane. Similarly, we add a list of element handles to sum over and specify that each of these elements depends on three vertices. So we will be differentiating six-dimensional subproblems, three vertices per triangle times two variables per vertex. And we can then specify a lambda function to be evaluated for each triangle. Inside this function, we access our three vertex positions in a specific way, such that the interface can infer the local-to-global index mapping. We can then perform computations with these variables and with any constant data that exists outside this function. Here we first check if our triangle is flipped, and then compute the symmetric Dirichlet energy. For this we use many functions that are provided by eigen, such as a 2x2 matrix inverse, determinants, and norms. We can then evaluate our scalar function in different ways. For example, we could just compute its value without derivatives. This is something we will need inside a line search. Or we can in addition evaluate its gradient, or the full set of function value, gradient, and sparse Hessian. Another feature is that it can automatically perform a positive definite Hessian projection on a per element level. Now with this and a few more simple helper functions that we provide, we are ready to implement, for example, a projected Newton solver in just a few lines of code. So in each iteration, we compute the current function value, gradient, and projected Hessian, and then use these to compute an update direction, check a convergence criterion, and perform a line search. And this is really all we need to do to implement a basic mesh parameterization algorithm. Of course, there are more advanced algorithms for this specific problem, but this one here is really easy to implement and can be the basis to start exploring different objective functions and different solver modifications. Here is the resulting optimization sequence. We compared our runtime performance to other libraries, all within our sparse interface. TinyAD is similar or even a bit faster than other forward mode implementations, like the one in Mitsuba or the Acorns code generator. Both backward mode implementations that we tried were slower. in particular ADOL-C, which benefits less from compiler optimization. These timings here are single-threaded. If we in addition parallelize the per-element computations, which is also very easy to do, we even save a bit more time. The good news for TinyAD is that the total time we spend in each iteration of this Newton algorithm is dominated by the linear solve. So by using automatic differentiation, we gain a lot of ease of implementation without sacrificing too much runtime. Our next experiment was tetrahedral mesh deformation in 3D, where we measure distortion per tetrahedron and add position constraints as soft penalty terms. Here we implemented four different distortion energies basically by just writing down their formulas. Computing their derivatives manually, however, would have been an immense task. And this is the total amount of code that we had to write for four different distortion measures, position penalties, and an optimization algorithm. Again, runtime is dominated by the linear solve rather than by differentiation. One advantage of implementing our own optimization algorithm instead of using a black box solver is that it's easy to add custom details. For example, if we want to optimize a spherical parametrization, then we have the additional constraint that vertices need to remain on the sphere. And for this, we implemented a technique from manifold optimization, where we represent vertex trajectories as tangent vectors, and then wind them around the sphere via a retraction operator. Again, it's possible to write all of this with very little code, and we can easily differentiate both the distortion measure and the retraction operator at once. Another really interesting experiment was re-implementing a method for frame field optimization from the paper Integrable Polyvector Fields. This is a quite heavy nonlinear method that can optimize a given frame field towards a curl-free frame field. Such a field is represented by two tangent vectors per triangle, so that would be four variables in our interface, and the objective is a sum over triangle elements and over these hinge elements that connect two triangles. These are the formulas from the paper that we need to implement, and some of them are written in complex arithmetic. We also added support for this by making sure that TinyAD doubles can be used inside the standard complex type. Again, we were able to write down the entire objective function in a very compact way, and the code doesn't even take up much more space than the formulas in the original paper. We compared our implementation against a reference implementation, and both produced the same solution. Ours is even a bit faster, while being a lot shorter to implement. We'd also argue that this code is very readable, because we can directly write down all the formulas that we want to evaluate, and besides not having to worry about the derivatives of all of these terms, we can also save a lot of the boilerplate code that we would usually write, for example for matrix indexing. In conclusion, we demonstrated that the simplest form of automatic differentiation is actually very well suited for geometry processing tasks if done right. We turned this insight into a C++ library that already proved to be extremely useful in practice and speeds up research workflows. We can easily experiment with new objectives and with new algorithms, or re-implement existing methods a lot faster. One limitation currently is that our performance relies very much on the fact that we choose the size of our subproblems statically. But in some applications, we might want to use dynamic stencil sizes. This is, of course, conceptually possible, but would currently come at a runtime cost. One way of extending TinyAD in the future, both by us as well as by the community, is by adding more advanced differentiation rules for common expressions. For example, for some matrix decompositions, there are, of course, a lot more efficient ways than differentiation per scalar. Such features can be added simply by overloading the respective function with TinyAD types and implementing the derivative rules. TinyAD is available on GitHub under the MIT license. We invite everyone to try it, use it in research projects, and contribute improvements. We also provide a repository with a growing list of application examples, including how to use TinyAD with different mesh libraries. Right now, we show how to use OpenMesh, PolyMesh, Geometry Central, and libigl-style matrices. Thank you for your attention, and we would be very happy to see TinyAD being used in future research.